just upset your own nervous system.
So turn it off.
Pardon?
Turn it off.
Yeah. Turn off the sound. Put it on mute. Okay, anyway, I every week, if you want a metaphor for mindfulness, it's this. This is thinking, the snow globe, and if you stop, if you just sit for 20 minutes, the mind clears. The natural state of the mind is clarity. But in our culture, the natural state of the mind is that. So we're constantly being stimulated to look like that in order to, we think, by doing this, we believe we're going to get to clarity and inner peace. But all we do is just keep stirring up the snow globe of thought. So this is a really good metaphor for the practice of meditation. And mindfulness basically is meditation, but it's portable. In other words, we think of meditation as being something where you sit, you're not going to meditate over here, right? But then if we take that meditation on the road and go to Walmart, it's mindfulness. So now I'm just meditating or being mindful of what I'm doing as I do it. So I'll become mindful of what my mind is doing when I'm doing something other than being identifying with what my thinking is about what I'm doing. So anyway, I wonder what I'm going to do next week, because last week we talked about the Pope. The weekend before that we talked about a primitive Baptist church that was abandoned. It was a historic, it was like Germany. Everybody died out. it was just the last of the primitive Baptist churches in North Carolina. Come in.
Sorry.
It's okay. So it was like everybody had died off, and it was just the building was left. So we talked about that. And then last week, I was kind of obsessed with the Pope's coming, and what did that mean? And so this week, a friend of mine provided me with an adventure, which I'm going to talk about, and it's called A Date with a Turd. Now, hope... this is an ambiguous. What does that mean? It's an ambiguous statement. It could be a little article about I had a date with a turd, meaning a bad blind date. That guy was a piece of work. Okay? It could be a date with a turd. Or meaning that would be a metaphor for a real stinker. You know. Or it could be a date, that you eat a date with a turd. Two things. I hope the word, if the word turd disturbs you, that's part of this talk. Think. So this is kind of ambiguous. It's kind of like the card I handed out, would you like to see my pride and joy? I'll show you. You want to see my pride and joy?
Joy. Oh, God.
What is it?
My business card.
Oh, it's your business card.
Oh, my God.
I'd like one, Ann. I didn't get one.
You didn't get one? Okay.
Because no, it does. Only my second time in the session, so I'm
okay. All right. Maybe I don't know. There you go. Okay. But see, that right there is ambiguous.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because if I say you want to see my pride and joy, you think you're going to go see somebody's kid or dog or truck or something like
that. And also when you look at this, you're thinking, okay, he's in the cleaning business.
Right.
I mean, seriously.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that would be another assumption. Right. But there's always a laugh or a smile when I hand that out, because the assumption that it's going to be somebody's kid and I got a smile, or their dog or something, my pride and joy, When that assumption is broken, you just see the fact. Well, he really said pride and joy. You know, so the actual fact that it's pride and joy is a surprise, because we expect it to be something else. So the story here, let me tell you the story, then we can go back and see how this fits into mindfulness or meditation. So anyway, I have a friend of mine, and he's been going through some difficult times with his business, and his income fell off, and he was behind his mortgage payment. So he came over the other day, and he was sitting in the backyard in his truck, pickup truck, talking on the phone. And I have a, my duty at home is to walk the poodle. We have a little toy poodle. Mm-hmm. So I have to walk the poodle, and my wife always says, take a Kleenex. So the poodle poops, you know. So I got to go out and stand there and wait for the poodle to poop, and then I pick up the poop with the Kleenex. So I walked over to my friend. He just pulled up, and he was talking on the car. And so I knocked on the window, you know, boom, boom, boom. When he's talking on the phone, he rolls down the window, you know. And I just reach in holding the little Kleenex with the poop turd, you know. I just go like that, you know. And he looks at me, he smiles, and he reaches up and he feels it. And then he realizes what it is. And so he, get out of here, you know, get out, you know. He breaks up, so we had a big laugh. But anyway, that was like, you want to see my pride and joy? So in other words, he expected maybe a date. Or, you know, he expected a gift. But it was a turd. But anyway, so that started the day. So what happened, we spent the whole day that day. He was trying to call up, the bank told him they were going to foreclose on his house at 5 o'clock. And he was late in his payments, so they weren't giving any more grace, you know. And he had $3,000, but he needed $1,700. He didn't have that last $1,700. The bank would, no, 5 o'clock, that's it. And after 5 o'clock, you got to pay the whole thing. Bam, and he could not get him to work with him. He was calling up connections, family, friends, trying to get the money, and nothing would come. Even his mother even sent him a credit card. She's in England. She had sent him a credit card, but the bank wouldn't take it because she wasn't there. Mm. You know, other people had put money in the bank, but they couldn't get it transferred in time for 5 o'clock. So nothing was getting the money in for 5 o'clock, no matter how much he tried. No matter how many people he called, whatever, everything was falling apart. So I was with him that day. So he was gradually just disintegrating, you know, because he's going to lose his house, and which was a great blow to his ego, because he was always and felt like he was always in control of his world, and now he was not able to control this. So finally, it. He was sitting in our house. He was sitting in the living room. I'm still on the phone trying to find the money, you know. And I remember sitting in my office, and I said, I was looking around for a ball. I felt like, boy, I want a ball. I'd take this. If I had a ball, I would take it in there. I'd say, Sam, look. And I would take the ball, and I would drop it on the floor, and the ball would bounce, being a metaphor that you'll bounce back. You know, you'll bounce. Is this rock bottom? If it is, the ball will bounce. So, but I didn't have a ball, so I didn't do that. So anyway, he leaves, and at about 5:15, he comes back, and he is just all smile. When he went away, he was a turd, really. But when he came back, he was a date. In other words, he was all smiles, and he says, "You would not believe what happened." So I was really, you know, I had gone to the bank and get one last try to get him to hold, to work with me, to do something. He said, no deal. So I said, well, screw it. Just go ahead and foreclose. I don't care. Do it. So he left. And he went downtown, I guess, to some store. And he saw somebody down there that he had seen 2 years ago. They'd left town. He hadn't seen him for 2 years. And he'd done some business with him. My friend's a contractor, done some business with him. So the friend said, hi, Sam, how you doing, you know, and how you doing? And he said, you know, I've got, what's the matter? He looked, you know, looked down, and he told him his story. So he said, well, I'm back in town and I've got two houses and I need to have some work done on them and I want you to do the job. Fine, thank you very much, But he said, but what's going on today? He says, well, I need this $1,700 by 5 o'clock. And it was now about 4:30. And so he says, oh, is that all? Well, here. So he reaches in his pocket and pulls out a wad of bills and counts off the hundreds and says, here. So he said, you can either pay me back or just take it off the charge for the houses, for the job. So Sam, he just could not believe this happened. So he took the money, went running back to the bank, slams it on the floor, here, Dan. So anyway, that was the story. And then when he came back to tell us about that, he brought in a box of dates for us. He's very sweet dates. If you look it up, a date, if you saw a date and a turd on the ground, you might mistake them. They might, there's. So I guess the story began with a turd and ended with a sweet date. Is it getting? I think I have to turn the air conditioner on. I think it's getting a little warm. Actually, there's heat coming out of here.
This is a little bit close to the...
Huh?
Pull this away.
Too much? Okay, is that better? Is that better sound?
Yeah.
Okay. So getting too much breath in there or something? Okay. Too much meat. Okay, so anyway, this was a... very interesting story because it has a lot of wisdom in it to see. First of all, but we and this is something that people will come up with different stories or different meanings to this. One person might say, well, God intervened. Or you have an angel. Or it was just luck. Or good karma. Or, we could come up with different stories to explain this. But in the tradition I work with, which is the Buddhist tradition of meditation, There is a different paradigm that we use to help understand. And this has taken me a long time to really understand. But if I want to turn my turd into... Now this is a metaphor now. We're moving into turd as a metaphor for an unsatisfactory situation. I'm in Walmart. And I'm really getting irritated because the woman in front of me that I thought was going through is now jamming up the whole line. That's a turd. In the sense that I'm experiencing an unpleasant emotion or experience because of an external situation in the world. So a situation has become a turd for me. And it could be a minor little thing. Or it could be a panic attack. The size of it is by degrees, very subtle or very big. But the metaphor means that I'm experiencing this situation as a negative. And of course that a negative basically means to me it should not be this way. In other words, if I'm in Walmart and the line gets blocked up and I find myself being irritated with it and stirred up, the reason for that is that because I expect that the line should move smoothly. That's my expectation of how it should go, but now there's a jam and that person is to blame. It shouldn't be this way. It should be going smooth. This is a very simple everyday thing. You see. But basically my irritation or my turd is because the situation is not going the way I expect it or think it should go. So there is a disjunct or a separation between my story of what should be and what actually is. So the turd is not in the story. It's not in the woman in Walmart. The turd is in me. You see? But I assume and believe that the turd is the woman, that she's the cause of my dissatisfaction. But the truth is, I'm the cause of my dissatisfaction, not the situation. So how do we turn the situation that I'm experiencing as a turd into a sweet date? Well, in this practice, the first step in the practice of mindfulness is recognizing that there is a turd. In other words, that recognizing that here is something for me to work with. In other words, you can't change a turd into a date unless you have a turd to work with. I hope this is not using this word, it's not messing anybody up, but it really...
Well, in other words, your expectations basically are the problem, not the situation.
Yeah, just like with the pride and joy. Your expectation is that he's going to show me a picture of his pride and joy, which is a metaphor for his child or dog or truck or his new house or his kitchen or whatever. Something the person has got pride and joy in. You know, it's going to be something, and I'm going to have to put on a smile to be polite. So that's my prediction of what the situation is, and when the situation proves to be utterly opposite and just very factual, the expectation collapses and I laugh. So the laughter is the date, is the sweet date. The laughter happens when I see that I am the cause of the turd that I'm experiencing because the situation is not what I expect it to be. So getting back with my friend, suddenly his something happened that shifted the world from negative to positive. Something happened that shifted his world from a turd to a date. Suddenly everything was a turd, everything was miserable, everything was the end. I've lost my house, I'm a failure. My friends, my life, my dead father even will see that I'm an utter, absolute failure, no good turd. So that's where he was. And then suddenly, he's got the money, he's got a reprieve, he's got energy, he's happy, he's got a lot of business deals in the works that he's doing, you know. So suddenly the road was bright, whereas before it was the end of the road. Something shifted. So basically this practice is discovering how we can create the conditions for that shift in our life so that we can, in our everyday life, notice the turd, so to speak, and transmute it into a date. In philosophy, this is called alchemy. During the Middle Ages, the science of the Middle Ages was alchemy. And the alchemist was a scientist who wanted to know the formula that would change base metal, like lead or base metal, into gold. So basically this is a metaphor. How do we change our mundane, retired, everyday life, that is, you could say, base metal, into gold? Or how do you turn a date? How do you change a date or a turd into a date? So basically, this is the basic fundamental question of the practice of meditation and mindfulness. And I really feel, and this really doesn't fit our understanding of the world and how what reality is. I mean, we in our culture believe that each of us is fundamentally created and rather powerless to change the world. So we're kind of like in the world, and the world does things to us, but I'm not creating the world. I'm not creating my world. I'm created somebody else. Their God or a situation or bad luck or fate is creating the world, and I'm in it. You know, so we're kind of like, that's the way we kind of look at things, you know. But what happened with my friend was that the, if you remember Charles Dickens' book, Tale of Two Cities, it begins, the famous lines, it was the best of worlds and the worst of worlds. The best of day and the worst of day. So that day with my friend was basically the worst of days and the best of days. It was the same day. But one minute it was the worst of days, the next minute it was the best of days, you know. And it changed in an instant. So that instant of change is always right now. You know, it's not, we think of it in terms of, well, I'd like to get to that place where it changes in the future. What can I do to get to it? You know, what do I have to meditate or practice yoga, go to church? You know, what do I have? Tell me what to do to get to that place where the shift happens. Well, you can't get to the place where the shift happens because the place is always now. So the present moment, the now that we're always living in, is always potentially the worst of moments and the best of moments. And whether it's the best of moments or the worst of moments depends on how we perceive it. So my perception and my assumptions of what this world is creates the world in which I live and experience things. And if that assumption drops, like it drops when you get the card, my assumption that this is a pride and joy, he's going to show me his dog, you see, when that drops, there's a shift going on, and suddenly you see exactly what is. It's just a picture of a pride and joy. He was telling the truth, just the facts. I was the one that was providing the story that wasn't true. So when we see that we're providing or creating a story that isn't true and overlaying it on the world, you see, and when we see that we're doing that, the story drops and the turd becomes a date and we laugh.
Yeah, but I don't quite understand that, because basically you can shift your thinking into improving it and saying, okay, I'm not going to get upset about the lady in front of me in line taking a half an hour when I'm in a hurry. But like in your friend's case, if somebody hadn't come along to give him the money, his basic attitude would not have changed.
It would have come true.
Yeah.
The worst day would have come true. He'd lost his house.
In other words, he more than likely would not have realized that, okay, I can get another house somewhere down the road. This is not the end of the world.
Right. Yeah, okay, well, the first thing that you asked there, just for the repeat, let me repeat it, you know, is that, do I need to change my thinking in order to get this shift to happen? And the answer is no. It's not changing your thinking, but seeing the fact that I'm creating a story that creates my dissatisfaction or my worst day. In other words, if this is very difficult to understand, and that's why this classroom is not filled up. because this is the practice of awakening awareness that is aware of what my mind is doing, which is a story. Our minds are storytellers. Our minds create the story of the world we live in, and the hero of the story is me. I mean, each one of us has a me, a sense of me that we believe has been here since birth, or a little kid. I got to be me, I got a name, and I've gone through all my life with this little me having experiences, getting good things, losing things, having a history, whatever, and then someday, you know, and then I'll die and then me will be gone. But there is a story of me with a character, a hero in it, or heroine, called my sense of me. You see? And so I see everything in the world that I see has meaning in terms of my story of me, how things should be, how things are supposed to be, why I'm a victim, why is not things working out, you know? So my friend's story of me was, I've done everything right. I've done the best I can. I've done the best jobs I can. I've done the best I can to please my father and God, and I'm a failure. You see, that I've failed. So that was his story. I know him, he's a friend. So that was the despair that was bringing in there, because he realized that all of the efforts that he had put in could not save him from the foreclosure. Yeah.
So then when he finally just let go,
it shifted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Instead of trying to manipulate everything.
Right.
So.
Yeah. Exactly. You hit the point right on the head. Is that when we see that our story of what should be is not working, then that opens up the opportunity for a shift to happen, because in other words, when we let go of the old story, a new story is able to be written. So the new story was the money, the guy was right there with the money, you see. If he had not gone through all of that suffering of the bad day, he would not have gone in despair wherever he ended up, you know, maybe at Super Dollar, I don't know what he was doing, you know, but he was downtown doing something, you know, and he made the connection with the new story. So, you know, so you see, this is really difficult to understand. You can't really say it's just blind chance. It's too intricate for that. And then we usually explain it by saying, well, God did it, or it's a miracle, you see, or something, well, that explains it, you know. But at the same time, in this tradition, in the Buddhist tradition, it tries to seek understanding without using miracles and angels and deities and God, you see. So it's more of a way of understanding my life, you know, I have a God or belief in God. That's not worth it. But it's a way of understanding that sees into myself as being responsible for the world that I create, instead of blaming it on God or the devil. You know. So yes.
It's interesting. I had an email the other day from someone about life is a train journey, and you meet your parents at the beginning.
Yeah.
And you go on to the next stop, and someone else, they depart, and someone else comes on, a lover, a friend,
yeah,
or whatever, and then at the next stop you have some other changes that take place. People get off the train,
yeah,
new ones get on, and you go on,
yeah,
on this train journey. And I think, to me, that was, I copied it because I thought it was so thoughtful, and exactly what it is. I mean, it's sometimes when somebody gets on, you have an unhappy experience, and you just go through it, and
or a beautiful experience.
Right.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, I use. Yeah, that's a good metaphor. The one I use is a cruise ship. Yeah, like we're all on a cruise ship. People get on. People get off.
Right.
You know, I mean, people. People die. But yeah. We, you know, people disappear from our life. People die. And where did they go? Well, they were here a minute ago, and now they're gone.
Somebody else replaces.
Somebody comes on. Right. Yeah. Right.
And I thought the train idea.
Yeah.
A cruise ship is very different. I've been on cruise. I mean, people get on, and people that they normally wouldn't talk to or wouldn't be friendly with.
Yeah.
It's like a little town. Everybody seems to be polite and friendly and nice,
yeah,
to everyone else. And you make very quick friendships, but the friendships usually, most of them, few of them last, right. Majority of them you lose.
Most of them are like Facebook. Facebook is like that.
Well, I'm not on Facebook?
Well, anyway, I write on Facebook a lot, in other words. So, but that idea, well, what a cruise does, or a train, or the, what was the famous train that used to make movies about it that would go through Europe, you know?
Express.
The what?
The Oriental Express,
you know, so a lot of movies, detective stories and cruises. But what these do are, is that basically they take a group of people away from the world and their stories. In other words, when you get off the cruise ship, your story is waiting for you. Oh, I got to go to this, I got to go do this, handle this job here, my mother-in-law's coming, I got all these worries now, I got this stuff, you know, to do, my duties, and then I got my attitudes about these duties, and the fears about all this is waiting for me. But while I'm on the cruise ship, ideally I leave that on the shore. And so that opens me up for adventure. Now I can meet people that I would not have ever stopped to talk to back in the world, you know. But now I'm in this free zone, you know, I'm disconnected from my story, and I'm able to be interested and meet people in a space that is outside of the world in my normal orientation to the world. Yeah, so that, you know, and so people are open to just other people.
But it doesn't last.
Doesn't last, no. Because the world has inertia. This is why meditation is like, you can sit for meditation, like this, right? So you sit for meditation, and the mind is going, thinking, and you just sit, and you just be patient, and you just let it, you just don't enter, you don't engage your thinking, which is the world. So the cruise ship is kind of like this, in the sense that when you sit for meditation, you're getting on a cruise ship. Now you're disengaging from the world for 20 minutes, okay? All your laundry and your taxes and all the worries will be there. But now I'm just going to sit and not identify with thinking. Thinking goes on, yada, 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 going on, like the breaking news at the bottom of the CNN thing, you know. Breaking thought here. This is important stuff. Think about this. And you sit. You may go with it. Fine. But then you come back. I'm aware of the breath. I'm thinking about the breath. So you come back to the breath. And then thinking, breaking news, and you go with that, oh, breath, and you come back to the breath. So with the practice of sitting with the breath, allowing thinking to go on, you eventually end up with clarity. So now when you go to Walmart, and thinking comes in and says, oh my God, this stupid woman is messing me up, you know, she shouldn't be here, she should be allowed in this line. You know, and all this, you know, she's breaking, see, she's got 25 items and it's a 10-item line. You know, that's wrong. You know, she's holding me up, right? She's messing up my world. Thinking. Breath. Oh, okay, so I come back to breath. And the thinking about the horrible woman that's screwing up my world just goes. And I kind of smile. It's like a little Buddha smile comes up. I'm okay, you know, I'm okay. This is not the end of the world. This is not a big turd. This is not the worst of days, right? It's the best of days. You know, so suddenly, by letting go of our attachment to thinking in our story, it becomes the best of days. So actually that shifts. And then we might strike up a conversation with a woman, like on a cruise ship. And she might have some story about her bad day. And suddenly now you have struck up a conversation. Pardon?
I have another class.
Oh, okay.
Sorry about that. It's
all right. It's all right. Got your thing? Okay. Which class is... Boy, he's gone. Is that... Which one is it? Archaeology or something, I don't know,
anthropology.
Anthropology, that's a popular class.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That could wait.
Huh?
That could wait.
Well, I think a lot of people that would come here are probably in there.
Yeah, that attracts a lot.
Yeah, I got on Monday, so I wouldn't compete with yoga. Now I'm competing with that.
You'll always be competing with somebody because there's so many classes.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Well, that's all right. Yeah, so what we're looking at is the does the world really change when I drop my story of the world? Do I really change the world? I mean, did my friend really create the man who had the money for his relief? Or was that just like some marbles hitting each other in space, you know, like a lucky marble? A lucky marble came by at just the right moment and hit him and said, here's the money. Well, what are the odds of that, you see? But he has a history of this, these ships, you know, even though he doesn't, he forgets. He told me another one, like he was in the gas station and getting some, he needed, didn't have any cash or something, but he needed, he didn't have enough money for gas or something like that. So he looked in the car holder and there was $2. So he goes into the store and he says, give me a lottery ticket. And he gets a lottery ticket and gets $50. And he goes out and pays for the gas. So, luck, okay? Maybe so. But, well, I experienced this. I'm not very active at it now, but I'm a retired photographer. But I used to always have, you know, and people would call up, like right here. They would call up and say, I want to have a picture taken. When can I come in? I say, well, come in at 2 o'clock next Friday. I'll forget to write it down on my calendar. Or if I do write it on the calendar, I forget to look at it. So next Friday, I go to Costco or someplace. And I'll come back home. And this happens over and over. I'll come back home an hour after the appointment. And the appointment is an hour late, coming in the front door exactly as I come in the back door. And they're apologizing for being late. So, I mean, this is not, you know, so this happens over and over. So this basically is a... you see, our society has a fundamental belief, our culture, that we are out of alignment with reality and we need to do something in order to get in alignment with it. You got to get a diet, you got to get some self-help program, you got to go see a guru, you got to do yoga, meditation, you got to go to therapy, you got to get a better car, you got to do all these things to get into alignment with reality so you feel okay with the situation you're in. If I don't feel okay with the situation I'm in, I'm out of alignment with the situation and I imagine a better situation, like I'd rather be home or at another store or at another time. You see, so I'm imagining a better situation than the one I'm in because the one I'm in is painful. But we could call that being out of alignment with it. If you're in alignment with something, you are one with it. If I'm on a bicycle and I'm falling off, I'm out of alignment with the bicycle, with balance. But when I get my balance, I'm going to, we all see this, you know, when we first learned to ride a bike or if we ever taught a kid to ride it, you get the training wheels and they're discovering balance. You can't give them balance, they have to find it. But when they find that balance, the training wheels take off, fall off, and the kid takes off on the bike with a great big smile of joy on his face, you see. I've got it. I discovered balance with, now that is a metaphor, because I have, the kid has discovered balance with the terrain. So now, wherever he goes, if he's going up or if he's going down, left or right, he maintains the balance. So he's in alignment with the body, with the ground. You see that? People then go into extreme sports like mountain bike climbing. So now they test their balance. Now, can I stay in balance if I'm going down a cliff? Or if I'm, you know, if I'm riding a mountain bike down, you know, or if I'm jumping over 10 cars, can I keep my balance? So the kids, you know, so the extreme sport people keep testing their balance to push it to new levels. You see, can I maintain my balance in this situation? Well, how about this one? Of course, a lot of them come to the final situation where they lose the balance and they crash. You know, but anyway, that's part of the game they play. So this whole idea of maintaining balance with the changing world. So our world is always changing. The situations are always different. Can I be centered and be at balance in that world? Can I be at balance in Walmart in the same way that I'm at balance at home watching TV? Can I have the same center of balance when I'm arguing with somebody about a payment on the, you know, foreclosure of the house, you know, when everything is going my way? Can I maintain my center when things are not going my way and when things are going my way? Or is it just when things are going my way that I can be centered? But the moment, everything is always the worst of days and the best of days, you see. So, so this whole idea that we have to do something in order to get into balance with the world so that we'll feel at home in the world is a Western assumption that this is the way the world is. We assume that we have to exert effort to fix our world to make it a better place because we're dissatisfied with the place we're in. We have to make it better. People, we all see this, people come into a room and another person will say, this is just perfect, and another person will find something that would make it a little better. You know, well, this needs to go over here. You know, then now it's good, you know. And then someone else will say, no, this, you know, that, you know. So we see the fault. We're quick to see the error, and quick to, we see other people, and we're quick to see the fault, and quick to come up with a fix. Well, you ought to be doing that, you see. So the practice that we're inquiring into here is that, is there something we're missing in our culture? Could the truth be that we're always in balance all the time and the world is always our home, you see, and that we can't do anything to make it better than it is? That I can't do anything to make myself better than it is right now. We see this all the time. As we get older, now this is an interesting question. I was just thinking about this morning. There was a little video on Facebook which showed movie stars like Rock Hudson or Robert Redford or, you know, all of our aging movie stars, and it showed them in a moving bit video backwards. So it would go from who they are now backwards to when they were just handsome, beautiful movie stars in their youth, you know. So there was Robert Redford when he was a handsome youth, and now wrinkled old Robert Redford, you know, going back. So you take all these movie stars, men and women, there they are now, old, wrinkled, going back to when we remembered them as gods and goddesses, you see. Now, the question is, are we someone who is getting old? In other words, am I that person when I was young and I've now gotten old? Or am I a completely different person, brand new right now, from that person when I was young? This is the way I feel. I mean, I look at myself when I was young. I don't know who that person was. You know what I mean? Every moment we are a brand new person, but we see ourselves in terms of one person getting old, a me getting old. So we look in the mirror and say, oh, I used to be, oh no, God, there's another wrinkle. You know, so I'm just adding on wrinkles to this image of a youthful person I used to be, you see. So my uncle, who I took care of for a year and a half, had a stroke in his right leg, paralyzed his leg, and he was a photographer in Tampa, and he was very active, always in control. It was Tommy's world. He was always in control of his world. He had beautiful, in other words, he, when I went to visit him with my mother, who was my mother's brother, we'd go visit Tommy, we would be in Tommy's world. He'd take us to dinner, he'd drive us around in his Lincoln, show us about how wonderful his life in Tampa was. you suckers up there in the north are just freezing to death. We're in paradise down here. You know, that kind of, I've just got it perfect, So then he has a stroke and he can't walk. And so he just gave up. I went down to rescue him because his partner had died of cancer. And so I went down there to see what I could do. And he couldn't stay where he was because he had no family, and he didn't want to leave. He didn't want to come back to. He didn't want to leave his Tampa, So he was stuck, and he said, basically, I want to die. I used to be able to do everything, and now I can't do anything. So the end of story. That was it. The Tommy that was, well, that's just gone. And this Tommy here is worthless. Just might as well, just let me die. So he was just basically seeing himself not from of who he is now, but who I was. You see, and now I'm this, and I hate this. I want, and I can't be what I was, So, but that's an assumption. That would be so. If we look in the mirror in the morning and we see ourselves, do we see ourselves as somebody who is getting old and is not? And then we don't compare with that, you see, because now we're adding decay and old age sickness and death. We see that, you see. Or do I see myself as being brand new? Fresh. In other words, do I see myself as a turd or a sweet date? You see? Or do I see myself as the pride and joy of that I thought I was going to be seeing? My assumption that the pride and joy was going to be a picture of the guy's dog. Or do I see the fact? Just a jar of pride and joy, you see. Do I see myself as a fact when I look in the mirror? Basically, which is seeing myself with clarity. See how clear that is. So if I see myself with that clarity, that self is beautiful. But if I see myself with that, you see, with my story of me, who me is now getting old and this is the end, I'm just seeing a story. I'm not seeing the reality of me, which is always already new. See, so it's always the best of me instead of the worst of me. You see, but if I see the worst of me, that's my projection on it. That's my assumption about it. And then I live in it. Then I feel it. Then my body does feel old. Now I start getting old age sickness. And I can't walk, and I start going over, and my mind's going, and the whole thing is going, because I believe it. You see? So there's a lot more to this than just, this has a profound message, I find, in my own life. I mean, I'm 78, and I'm standing here talking to you as fresh as a daisy. in the sense that I have no idea in my mind that I'm getting old and this is the end and I'm in my last days, and so forth. That is not in here. You see. And if it did come in, I would see it like that. and I would not let it stick. If it sticks, it's kind of like Velcro. So that thought, you see, would, oh, I'm getting old, this is the end, would stick. And then it would collect thoughts to it. And it would begin to get bigger, you see. And now I'm worried. Oh, now I got a thing. Oh my God, this is a sign. Yeah, this is it. You know, oh, there's a pain now. I know that. Oh, I forgot my keys. Oh my God, I got Alzheimer's. You see, so all of that evidence now begins to accumulate and justify my story about this being the end. And it's just a story. It's not the ground. It's not the facts. You see. How are we doing back there?
About 4 minutes.
Well, go ahead and switch, and I'll see what I wanted to do now. Would somebody say something?
I was
to do that or something. Do something that's useful. That's just going with the geese to Miami. You see. So with the practice of not going with the geese, or if you use the idea of, you know, a lot of weeds are like little Velcro, and the seeds will stick to your clothes, you know. And if, you know, like they want to grow a tree there, or they want to grow on your leg, you know. So these thoughts, negative thoughts, want to grow in the mind. But you can't, the practice is not to fight them, but to just see them. Because see, the awareness that sees a thought trying to lodge itself in the mind is a living awareness. That's who we are. We're not the thought. You see, we're not the thought. We are the awareness that sees the thought. But our conditioning and our society has made us identify with the thought, so we believe we are what we think. So if I think I'm sick, I believe I'm sick, and sure enough, I'm going to be sick. Because I want my belief to be true. You know, if I believe this person is a turd, they're going to be a turd to me. I will not experience them as a date, a sweet date. They're just going to be a stinky person. You know, because I believe it. So the world conforms to our belief. But when we see that, we realize that that is creating the pain we want to get out of, and we just stop it. It's kind of like if you're standing there with your hand on a hot plate and you begin to feel something burning and you see that your hand is on the hot plate, you don't have to think, I should take my hand off the hot plate. I see my hand's on the hot plate. So the seeing is the action that takes my hand off the suffering. So if you see the negative thought trying to implant itself in your mind, the seeing of it lets it dissolve. It goes on. It has no authority if you don't believe it. If you believe the thought, you give it your authority, and now it is controlling you. Now you live in the thought you believe. This is very, this is very observable if we have the understanding that reframes the way our whole mind works, the way the whole thing works, you see. So we just, it's not magic or anything, it's just changing the way we see the way we create the world we live in. And it's the fundamental truth that we create the world we live in, that we're not created in some miserable world that either God or the devil made, or just blind, stupid chance threw us into this thing, I didn't do it. You see, that takes us out of the game. Now I'm just a pawn in a stupid world. I'm here for a little while, then I die. What does it mean? Nothing. You know, that is a Western view, not the only one, but a popular one. And this practice is a single idea that changes everything. I watched the movie The Theory of Everything about Stephen Hawking, and he said, as a physicist, he was looking for the single theory that explained everything. The single idea that will explain everything. So we're kind of like looking for that single idea that will explain everything, because there's so much of life doesn't have any meaning. It doesn't fit. You know, like my friend with the foreclosure, that whole thing just didn't fit the way the world was supposed to be. You know, but it's. Have you changed over?
Yes.
Okay.
I think it's getting cool in here.
Think it's getting cool now?
Yes.
Okay. Well, let me turn that off. We're going to use practice. Okay. Let's listen to the first exercise in Yoga Nidra. It takes about 8 minutes, and this is the setup of the Yoga Nidra practice, which basically is a practice of how to turn turds into dates by starting with the body. So let me see if this keeps its connection. The problem is that when I when all this goes to sleep, I lose my connection. And same.
So do we.
That's a good metaphor.
What's that?
That's a good metaphor for human life.
We all concur.
We go to sleep
and lose our connection, exactly. Okay, well that's connected. All right. Relax in the chair, hands in your lap, and just let this meditation be your guide for about eight.
Welcome to Yoga Nidra, the meditative heart of yoga. As your body begins to settle, you may wish to close your eyes in preparation for engaging this practice. Set your attention free to wander through your senses. Note the sounds around you in the room. The images and thoughts that are passing through your mind in this moment. And the feeling of your body. And as you do this, please allow my words to become your words as we enter into this meditative journey together. I invite you now through this practice to realize the timeless wisdom that lies hidden within you, that your underlying true nature is unchanging, heartfelt equanimity or presence that is always present amidst every circumstance of your life. With this realization, you recover your true radiant health and mental disposition that gives you the strength to meet, greet, welcome, and respond to every situation that you face during your lifetime. Everything is a pointer to your authentic ground of equanimity, being, or presence, which is always awake and knows the perfect response to every situation. For this reason, we affirm the following resolve as we enter into the practice of Yoga Nidra. I am awake, I am aware, and I welcome every perception as a messenger that is guiding me home to my authentic ground of being. Now feel and affirm this resolve as you quietly repeat it once more to yourself. I am awake, I am aware, and I welcome every perception as a messenger that is guiding me home to my authentic ground of being. And take a moment to find within yourself a heartfelt prayer that you feel about yourself, a friend, a lover, for health, healing, or enlightenment, and phrase it in your own mind, in the present tense, as a statement of fact and truth in this moment. And later on, at the end of the practice, you'll come again and pick up this affirmation and affirm it at the end of the practice. During this session, you're going to spend time perceiving your physical body as pure tactile sensation in order to experience a profound relaxation and letting go in both your body and your mind. As a way of beginning, you may enjoy taking a few moments now to readjust your body so that you're even 5 to 10% more comfortable and are ready to enter into deep meditation and self-inquiry. Bring attention into your mouth. Be aware of the sensations in the walls, the floor, and the ceiling of the mouth. Sensation in the lips, the teeth, the entire mouth as a radiant orb of sensation. Be aware of the tongue. It too is made up of sensation. Feel the tongue and the mouth simultaneously. And follow the sensations of the mouth out into the inner ear canals. And trace sensation from the mouth through the ears and out into the outer architecture of each ear. Feeling and exploring sensation in the folds and the valleys of the ears. And be aware of both ears simultaneously. Sensation. Be aware of the cheeks and the sensation of the nose. Perhaps even the feeling of the breath as it moves across the nostrils. Be aware of the eyes. Sensation in the orbits and the eyes themselves. Each eye is an orb of radiant sensation. And trace the feeling of the eyes back into the head itself. Be aware of sensation inside the brain. Sensation in the forehead, scalp, and the back of the head. And feel the back of the neck. And now bring all of these sensations together and feel the entire head simultaneously. Mouth, ears, nose, eyes, scalp, inside and outside. The head is an orb of radiance. Be aware of the back of the neck and the throat. And follow sensation from the throat down the shoulders, down the arms. And be aware of sensation in the palms of the hands. The palms of the hands, the fingers, the back of the hands. Can you feel the pulse, the vibrancy of the hands as a radiance of sensation and aliveness? And sense both arms simultaneously. And sense the throat once again. Sensation in the throat. And follow sensation down into the chest. Be spontaneously drawn to sensations that you come upon. So we're not inventing or creating anything here. We're discovering what's already the case. Be aware of sensation in the chest, the front, the back, and the sides. And follow sensation down into the abdomen, the front wall, the back wall of the abdomen, and the two side walls. The entire abdomen is an orb of radiant sensation. Follow sensation down into the pelvis. And be aware of the floor of the pelvis as sensation. The side walls, left and right, front and back. And can all of these sensations of the pelvis come together so it feels it's one radiant orb of sensation? Follow sensation from the pelvis down through the hips, like streams of flowing sensation into the legs, pouring down into the feet. And sense the feet and the soft bottoms of the feet, toes, both legs simultaneously. Feel the legs as orbs of radiant sensation. And now allow all of the sensations in your entire physical body to come together, like a symphony coming together harmoniously. Feel the entire body as a radiant orb of sensation. Feel the front of it, the back of the body, the left side of the body, right side of the body, the entire body simultaneously. And feel it as a radiance. The body as sensation radiating out in front, behind, left and right, below and above. The body as an orb of radiant sensation in your awareness.
Okay. Well, there's several things to, this is a very, this is the first of the five exercises in Yoga Nidra. And first one is the, basically this sets you up on how to do the whole practice. And the first thing that he brings up is the intention. So he's asking you to want to do the practice or have the intention to do the practice, just to see what's in it. I'm curious. I want to do this. You know, it's not to imagine any goal or enlightenment or, you know, great thing to arrive at, but just to do it and be curious about it as discovery. So the next thing he says, and this is a mantra that we should repeat all the time in Walmart or wherever we are, but it's, I welcome every perception as a guide to my essential ground of being or awareness or true self. So what that is, this is a rather profound instruction, because he's saying if you're in Walmart and you get irritated with the woman in front of you who is jamming up the line, welcome that irritation as a guide to your center or your ground of peace. In other words, to the clarity of the globe would be your inner, your natural state. So the turds that we experience in life, the irritations, the angers, the upset, the confusion, all these are perceptions of the world that we are by habit rejecting. So we want to fix it. I want to get away from it. I don't accept it. But if we change that and say, and we're in this practice, then we notice, oh, there's a negative thought about the woman in Walmart or whatever the situation is. And we remember the practice, and I say, it's okay for me to have that. I welcome it. So this changes the dynamics of our relationship with the world, because if I'm irritated with the situation, using the Walmart thing as an example, I'm irritated with the world because it's not the way I think it should be, you see. So that irritation then, we think, is about the world, but it's really a perception. So if I welcome the perception, I am welcoming myself. I am the perception, you see. But the illusion is that the perception is a report on something in the world that is not right. You see? That's an assumption, that my negative impression about this person or this situation is an accurate description of what the world is doing, and the world should not be that way, so I'm irritated. This flips the whole thing and says, try this. Welcome the feeling, the irritation, as being okay, and then what you do, the next thing you do is, so it doesn't take root, is that you switch your attention to the body. So you switch your attention, not from the person or the thought now, you switch your attention to the, if you're standing in Walmart, to the warmth in your feet or the energy in your hands. Can I feel the pulse of the energy in my hands instead of being irritated with the situation? So when I take my investment in the situation being irritated, my belief that the situation is irritated, when I take that investment in that belief and just put it in the present moment, which is my body, breath, feeling, hands, posture, air on my arms, feeling of my neck, you know, all of these places that we just visited, you see, if I put my attention there, that disengages me from the irritation of the negative impression of the world, and it dissolves. Now I discover a whole new way of relating to the moment. I'm not resisting it anymore, I'm not angry with it. I'm open to it. Oh, I note the woman has got a limp, you know. In other words, I become aware of the moment instead of resisting it and angry with it. And that opens up possibility. It opens up the potential of every moment to be that sweet date instead of the stinky turd. So I do the shift right there by remembering my practice. So this practice is something that we have to do in order to embed it in our mind so that it activates when we're out in the world encountering stress or in the family or just if you break a glass in the kitchen. You break a glass, is it just breaking a fact of breaking a glass? Or is it, oh my God, I'm such an idiot? See, if I say, oh my God, I'm such an idiot, clumsy, I should be more aware, and then maybe the person we're with says, you should be more aware. Why'd you do that? You're not paying attention. Oh, I'm not paying attention. My mind's, all of this stuff. It's just a fact. Just a fact of a broken glass. You see, there's no story. So even that in the home, little things like that, little upsets and things we do, you see, we all pile our story on. So if we practice, basically we're saying, I welcome that. I become aware of my mind projecting stories on everything and how that affects me. Doesn't take any effort. It's just a shift in the way we perceive what our mind is doing, and the helpful part of the practice is to get grounded immediately, ground yourself in the body, the sensations of the body, so that the negative thought that is coming in won't take root and grow with all the other negative thoughts there until you end up getting on medication, So it's a very effective, powerful, enjoyable practice, which is ideal for people who are not, in other words, we have time in order to play with the simple things in life rather than we're not dealing with big career changes and gigantic cosmic events of getting married and having a business and all that. We can devote our attention to the subtler things in our life, and these reveal the nuggets of wisdom, because everything is in a grain of sand. In other words, the whole when you say the whole ocean is in a grain of sand, or everything is, or in a body, if you say, well, every cell has the DNA of the whole body, so you can make a whole organism out of one cell, you see. Well, every event has our whole world in it. The simplest things contain our whole story. Our attitudes, the way we perceive, is all contained in these little simple things that can be looked into with this practice and with the intention to do it. So anyway, yes.
I wasn't here earlier today, and you call it yoga what?
Yoga Nidra. Did you get a CD?
The first one I got, but I didn't get the one you did, the green one.
All right, one of them is Yoga Nidra. That's what you just heard.
Okay, that's what I didn't get.
Okay. Well, then now you got that. Thank okay. You. This speaker is Richard Miller. He teaches this. He calls it eye rest, and he teaches it all over the country, and with great effect to veterans, peak stress, children, people of all different types of things, because it is a I call it the five apps for the worry mind. It shows you how to transcend worry and how not to be caught up in it.
This
They're teaching that to, my daughter is a computer consultant, and they're teaching that to returning veterans.
Yes. It's in the veterans' hospitals, very effective with post-traumatic syndrome.
Yeah, that's what she's working with her program.
Uh-huh. That's where it's primarily, that's where it's had the most impact. But you know, post-traumatic, we all have a certain amount of post-traumatic syndrome in the sense that we have grievances. In other words, if my best friend hurts me or something, I've got a grievance, you know, and so that lodges in me, you know, and that affects me. And it becomes becomes a traumatic event. Maybe small, but if it's still with me, that pain is like a mini post-traumatic syndrome. Of course, the vets are dealing with big ones, but we all have, so this is very effective in showing us how to get these Velcro stickers off of our mind.
And also, Google, I'm sorry to keep talking to it, but also sure. Google is allowing their employees, I understand, to have a yoga session like that.
Yes, mindfulness training, meditation, and yoga nidra, they're all going into corporations.
I think that's wonderful, really.
It's a far cry from the 60s.
Yeah.
When the 60s is when the there was a crack in the American collective mind, and all of these subjective self inner mystical things, meditation, drugs, all of this like poured up in like a volcanic eruption. And then the society reacted and clamped down on it. Reagan, the conservatives, law and order, put them all in jail. War on drugs, the whole thing, clamped down. Too dangerous, too chaotic. Society is disintegrating. We need Dirty Harry to come in, and the whole, the whole reaction to the chaos of the 60s and this opening up of this consciousness that had no discipline. Now over the years, now the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 20s, teachers, the people who went to India in the 60s to find a guru and try to figure out what this was, have now matured and they're writing books and teaching and bringing mindfulness and meditation to the corporate world, So it's, I really see it, having been around long enough, is that volcanic eruption of the 60s is now growing grass in our society, slowly, like grass things. And so you have all kinds of practices that turn you within, sprouting up, But there's more, it's not chaotic like in the 60s. It was like, hoorah, turn on, drop out, and we're going to change the world and go to war with it, And that whole hoopla, I've been watching Mad Men lately, and that really brings it all back. That is, that has fortunately... good, thank you.
I had class at 1:15.
Huh?
I had class at 1:15.
Okay, good. Good to see you again.
Hey,
come back. Okay. Well, we're done now.
Okay. That was good.
Yeah.